Hello and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this 142nd session of MIUI's iTalks webinar powered by MIUI Academy. This is Ms. Olu Gautam signing in as your host for this session, and I am so glad to welcome you for this session. Prior to the beginning of today's session, I request you all to drop your queries that you have in between the session to our live chat box so we can discuss it later on our discussion session. For now, I would like to introduce our today's guest without any delay. So joining us today as a speaker is Ms. Rebecca Sumalini to share her insights on topic Pediatric Low Vision. Before she begins, let me highlight her short introduction. Ms. Rebecca is a consultant optometrist at Institute of Vision Rehabilitation and Albi Prasad Eye Institute, Hyderabad, India. So Ms. Rebecca, I welcome you to our iTalks platform on the behalf of MIUI and all our participants. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Solu. I hope you can hear me.
Yeah, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you for your kind introduction, Solu. And especially thank you to Kapil for having me over to discuss in this session. I'm really glad to be here. And I should acknowledge, you know, I want to place a note of appreciation actually for the great work that MIUI Foundation is doing, you know, in terms of educating the eye care professionals in different aspects of eye care. I mean, that's really a tremendous work. I was just learning from Kapil, and otherwise also I did browse and had a look at it. I mean, that's really great, you know, having so many webinars, taking so much effort actually to educate the optometrist. Thank you so much. So let's get started. I hope my screen is visible, Solu.
Yeah, it is.
So I'll just carry on. So I have titled my talk as Pediatric Low Vision, Challenging Yet Rewarding. So hopefully by the end of the session, you all will understand as to why is it challenging and how can this be rewarding. Right. So I'm sure few things you may have already, you know, got it with the general practice that you are carrying out, or even in the pediatric care that you provide, that sometimes managing children can be really, really, really challenging. And yes, at the end of the day, the satisfaction that you get when you provide intervention and when you see the change in that child is really, really rewarding. So that's the whole point of it. But let's discuss in detail how to go about it. I like this caption. This is from one of the very popular pediatric hospitals here in Hyderabad. So it goes on to say that indeed it takes a lot to treat the little. I'm sure you will resonate with this as we discuss further. So for a minute or two, if we all can just go back to our childhood days. And just think about, like, you know, what are the learning components that we had through seeing? Like, for example, be it like, you know, our elder sibling trying to teach us to fix something. So we learn, we see and learn that particular thing from him or her. Or just by looking at our mom's angry expressions, you know, we try to set right our behavior, right? So there's a lot of learning that happens through seeing. But unfortunately, these children who have visual impairment miss out on this very important component of learning. So how do they go about in managing things? How do they go about, like, you know, what are the other alternative ways that these children can attain learning, right? Through seeing. So let us discuss further on that. So the outline of my talk is, first of all, to establish the need for low vision rehabilitation in children. First, we need to acknowledge, yes, that this need exists. And the second is the major portion of my talk will be concentrating on the clinical assessment and management of children with visual impairment. And now we only deal with ocular visual impairment, but there are children who have special needs as well. So those kids have vision problem, plus they also have other delays in like motor, speech, cognition, communication, etc. So all of these, I will be trying to, you know, put across some case examples, try to make it more relevant to you people. Okay, so I'll try my best to do that. For a minute, if we can again, like, you know, think about what we do on regular clinical day-to-day basis, how many of you probably just try to introspect yourself? How many of you actually write this in the medical records? Child is not cooperative. Child is not familiar with letters. Visual acuity measurement differed due to poor comprehension from the child, due to poor attention skills from the child, or child is actually, the infant, the toddler whom we are referring to is only fixing and following light. But whereas actually the child may have better visual ability than what is written. And for all you know, the negative statements that you'd written, that child is not cooperative, not familiar with letters, is it truly the child who is not cooperative? Or is it us as clinicians who can be a little better in assessing them by getting trained? So think about it. Next time when you write these statements in the medical records, try to avoid it. Try to think for a moment, can I do something different and get the response from the child, right? So put the onus on you. That time, that way it is much easier, you know, to document in the medical records and also to get some meaningful visual information from the child so that you can go about in the intervention process. So just a bit about the magnitude. I'm sure we all agree that childhood visual impairment is of a public health concern. 17.5 million children have moderate to severe visual impairment globally, and 1.42 million children have blindness. And we also see that the prevalence of visual impairment in low to middle income countries is way high compared to the developed countries. So what are the causes for this visual impairment? This is not an exhaustive list that I'm putting out here. I'm just trying to touch upon the important ones. So we see that the most important causes could be the uncorrected refractive errors, the congenital cataracts, the retinal dystrophies, and also the optic nerve pathologies. Now, this is common in across all the geographical locations. Now, to be specific about, like, you know, what are the leading causes in some of the geographical locations, we see that visual impairment due to corneal ulcers, due to the vitamin A deficiency and so on, due to measles, these are seen more commonly as a leading cause in the low-income countries. In middle-income countries, like even in India, we see that the problems such as retinopathy of prematurity seems to be more predominantly present. Whereas in developed countries, like let's take UK, mostly it is about the abnormalities in the visual pathway, like in the cerebral, like cerebral visual impairment, for example. Okay, so this is just to touch upon the most important causes of visual impairment. And as I mentioned earlier, it's not an exhaustive list. There are many more causes and much more subdivisions which you can actually look up to if you're interested in this. So now let's move on to this. So now we've understood until here that yes, there exists a great need for low vision rehabilitation in children, because we have seen that the visual impairment global burden is exceedingly high, especially in the low and middle income countries. So we as optometrists or as eye care professionals, first of all, have the onus on us to intervene in avoidable causes of visual impairment, like especially uncorrected refractive errors. Totally, it's, you know, belonging in our arena. Or else, if that is not possible, if a child is having irreversible visual impairment, then to provide low vision rehabilitation. Now, throughout, when I'm talking about the clinical examination, I want you all to just try to see and just try to imagine how you can actually, you know, take these pearls that I'm giving out in the clinical examination and try to use it in your own setups. So some of you may be in private practice, some of you may be, you know, practicing in an optical setup, or like, you know, a few of you in the hospitals and, you know, associated with collaborating with several other people. So try to think about it in one way or the other. You all are in patient care, right? So what can you do in your own way? You don't have to have all the sophisticated equipment. Probably some things are mentioned here, some things I may have missed out, but you don't have to have all the sophisticated equipment. In simple terms, how you can actually integrate the low vision care into the conventional eye care is what we'll try to see. Yes, there are cases which do need a complete low vision rehabilitation referral for, you know, in cases such as complex. So we'll talk about it. So it's also important to network in these cases. Okay, so let us try to see. So as part of the comprehensive low vision assessment, there are several steps actually which go into it. I'll discuss few of them here and the rest, you know, in detail later. So first of all, how do you think, you know, clinical observation, why do you think clinical observation is important? For all you know, we just start off thinking that, oh yes, history taking is the first thing that we're going to start with. No, first thing that you're going to do as part of your assessment, your assessment starts right away when you're escorting the child right from the examination, right from the waiting hall to the examination room. There are multiple observations which you can make if you're very keen, right? So important things like, you know, is the child able to walk by himself or herself? If the child is bumping into things, is it because of visual reasons, or does the child have any non-visual reasons because of which he or she is bumping? And is the child, like, you know, once you ask some simple questions, is he or she able to give that verbal response back to you, because based on this you can actually decide lot of your assessment procedure. With what tools am I going to assess? If the child is age appropriate, yes, this is the way I'm going to do. If the child is not age appropriate, probably have to come down one step down and try to assess with these kind of tools. So clinical observation plays a very vital role in the whole assessment procedure, followed by the review of medical records. Now, one thing that you need to understand here is if you are in a referral eye center, like how I am working in LV Prasad Eye Institute, definitely you're going to have some medical records when the child comes in. Mostly, at least 70 to 80% are all referral cases. So once the child comes there, it is good to actually look into what was told in the earlier medical records, what was written, like, what procedures the child underwent, when did the child last take glasses, and how compliant the child is with the glasses. You can check right away then and there based on the medical records. And now talking about low vision rehabilitation, whether the child already underwent any low vision rehabilitation before. So reviewing of the medical records gives us a very good idea. For example, in some cases, children can have multiple other issues. Like, is a child consulting the neurologist because of the neurological visual impairment, or is the child having any systemic health concerns? Like, in few cases we see. So that kind of information can be documented. Okay, so as part of the review of medical records. Now moving on to the most important component of history taking, I'll be spending one or two slides on it. So I'm not going to discuss it about it here. Then is the visual function assessment, obviously the crux of the whole assessment. Refractive error assessment, I'm sure, this is part of our conventional eye care, and this is actually more important in these cases, especially when, the children don't give response. You have to depend much more on your retinoscopy values. You cannot leave anything for subjective in some cases, right? Here in conventional eye care, like, when you're doing it for little older children or, for the adults as such, you can more or less get a retinoscopy value and rely more on your subjective. But no, herein you're going to totally rely on your retinoscopy value sometimes, right? And obviously binocular vision problems are very prevalent in these children. So yes, assessing them also is very important. Since this is about low vision assessment, we will also be talking about how to give trial of assistive devices. I have not mentioned in detail about assistive devices, but as part of case examples, I will, bring this topic up. And yes, to have a complete protocol in place, getting an anterior and posterior segment assessment, and then, ruling out if anything else the child has is also very important. So this is the comprehensive low vision assessment, all these points that we've discussed. So let's move on to history taking. I would suggest that, you can just remember these two C's here. Right? Just, even for your regular history taking also, you can remember, not just for pediatric as such. One is keep it comprehensive. Just writing gradual decrease in vision since 2 years, 3 years since birth is not going to help. It's not going to help the patient, is not going to help you also to proceed with further assessment. Keep it comprehensive. Write down all those points that are needed. For example, in children, you would like to document the birth history. Now, this is very important. Write down all the things that go into birth history, the birth weight, the birth cry, any issues immediately after birth, how is the maternal health. Okay, write down all the Apgar scores. So write down all those important bits in the birth history. Don't miss out on any of it, right? And then moving on to developmental history. Now you may ask me, how different is developmental history than birth history? Yes, definitely there is a difference. Here we talk about the child's overall development at the time he or she is presenting to you. For example, if the child is 5 years, so 5 year old child, we all know what should be the development. The child should be able to talk, walk, cognition also, to certain extent, he or she should be following your instructions, whatever you tell. So to certain extent, we all know, right? We all know the developmental milestones. How is the child doing as part of this overall development is very important here to document, right? And then it is also important, very important here is the educational history. So when you mention about educational history, usually this is what I tell my trainees also, that you write down in which grade is the child studying. That's very important. So now, for example, I understand that the child is, let's take a 12-year-old studying in grade 7. So then I'm going to be very sure the child is age appropriate, doing as per what is expected of him or her. But if the child is 12-year-old and still in grade 2, now this should give me the next question. This should prompt me to ask the next question as to why is it so? What is the reason for the lag in the studies. So then probably it could be a visual reason, it could be a non-visual reason, it could be family related issues which we may not be able to address, but at least we should find out, because if it is related to vision, then obviously the onus again is on us to deal with it. So usually what I also tell is, if in case a child is discontinuing education, so if at all it's a grade 6 dropout for whatever reason, again it's good to document that. Since when did the child discontinue the studies? Now, for example, I have a child who's discontinued studies for 2 years versus a child who's discontinued studies for 2 months because of visual reasons. The counseling that I'm going to provide for a child who's just discontinued for 2 months may be very easy, actually. May not be for very lengthy time. The child may already have not lost motivation still, versus someone who's sitting at home since 2 years. So all of this important bits of information, since when did they discontinue, also needs to go in, and what is the reason why they discontinued, right? And I also encourage you all to mention as to you know, what is the medium of education, because at least in India there are so many mediums of education like Telugu, Hindi, Marathi, Gujarati. So it's good to write down what is the medium of education, because once you get the trial of devices, like for example, I'm going to show a stand magnifier, okay, with the particular reading material. Like for example, I'm going to show a grade 6 English textbook and the child is from Hindi medium. And then you're writing that, you know, child is reading very slow with the stand magnifier. It, for all you know, it may not be the effect of the stand magnifier. It may be the effect because of you showing the wrong reading material to him. If you had shown him, you know, something of Hindi, some material related to Hindi, maybe he would have been faster. So it's always good to mention, these are very small bits, but actually they help a lot during assessment, right? So that is about the educational history. And also it's good to write down the model of school. For example, if the child is in mainstream school, the regular school, that is, or else if the child is in a special school. So some children, because of the existing visual impairment since childhood, like congenital visual impairment, they are advised to join the special schools for the blind. So is it so? Is the child studying there? Then what is the mode of education? Is it braille or is it regular print? Or is it regular print with devices already, with the assistive devices? Or is it large print, audiobook? So all of these things again come as part of the mode of education. So these are very important, you know, aspects to cover as part of the educational history. Now moving on to, actually, I'll say the heart of the history taking is the vision related activity limitations. I actually had some snapshots from our history taking form in special needs vision clinic, but this can be expanded, you know, even for the low vision cases as such, you know, complete history, very detailed as to even trying to understand the educational background of the parents also, so that to understand how much of support is there from the parents and all of that. So getting too much into details these are, but it's very important again. And then we are also going to this vision related activity limitations I was talking about. So here it's very important to understand that the parents are saying that, yes, the child does have problems since birth. Now, because of that concern, what are the difficulties a child is facing in his or her day-to-day life related because of the vision-related concerns? So, for example, the parents may say, yeah, the child is unable to copy from the board. You know, whatever the teacher is writing, the child is not able to copy, or the child is not able to, you know, read from the book. Okay, or is bumping into objects very often, especially in dim light. So all these bits are again very important, because based on that, your management is going to depend, and also your assessment. For example, if someone says, yeah, he bumps into objects, especially, you know, when it's dim, then obviously I will ensure that I measure the contrast sensitivity and also the visual fields. Okay, so these are very important bits of information, the vision related activity limitations. And the last one, obviously, the previous rehabilitative care. So herein, you're going to cover not only vision, you're going to cover all other aspects of rehabilitative care. I'm going to talk about it towards the end. Probably you'll have a better idea about it then. So the second C is conclusive. Now, once you know, yes, it's comprehensive, you've covered every aspect, and for all you know, you would have ended up writing 2 pages of history. And then you realize, oh, now what am I going to address first? There are so many things there. What am I going to address as my priority? Then you understand that, no, I'm going to make it conclusive. I'm going to summarize the whole thing so that I am clear, first of all, in my mind, that these are the aspects I'm going to cover in this visit. Now in the next visit, I need to look forward for what is, because in children especially, you will not be able to cover everything in one single go. It will be very difficult for you to also provide and for the child to follow the advice that you're giving, right? Many a times we just go with one specific device, what is the need of the hour, and then the next time what we see how the child is doing in that visit and come up with the go with the next device. Okay, so these are important bits. Keep it conclusive. Always prioritize what you're going to. That now, when you prioritize, you should keep in mind as to what the child is actually expecting or the parents and caregivers are actually expecting. Also write down as to who is the informant, because you know someone may be accompanying, but who exactly is the informant giving you away all this information? Because the next time, you know, having the same informant would be good. And also if there's any change in, you know, the way something is reported, then you obviously know that last time it was so and so person, but now this time it is this person. Okay, these are all important bits to follow in the history taking. Now moving on to visual functions, we have this five basic visual functions that we all refer to. We all know that vision is not equivalent to visual acuity alone. Vision comprises of five visual functions, and all those five visual functions are up here, right? So we'll discuss in detail. Before that, this is one of the clinical pearls. So in our institute, we've started this optometry season one. In fact, this is of the JAM pearls. JAM stands for just a minute clinical pearls. So it's all about educating, you know, the optometrists and the eye care professionals in a larger way. So here in what we do is we give away one clinical tip in one particular slide like this. It comes up. So if any of you are interested, in fact, you can subscribe to our, you can check on our LVPI YouTube channel. We have some of them already there. So you can please go back and check. So talking about the clinical tip here, tips to assess visual functions in children, not just restricted to low vision, but in general, choose assessment tools based on their developmental age. You may try to ask what is developmental age. Now there is something called chronological age and the other is developmental age. Chronological age is based on the date of birth of the child, and developmental age is how much is the child developing and how much is the difference between the chronological versus the development. So that will give us a developmental age. Child may be 7 year old, but the developmental age may just be of 4 years old. So according to the developmental age, is good to choose assessment tools. The second question could be, how will I know what is the child's developmental age? I'm not a psychologist, and not that every child undergoes psychological assessment and comes to me. Yes, very true. We are not psychologists. But one important thing that you can do is, with your interaction, you can at least understand as to how is the child's familiarity, what are the comprehension, how is the child's comprehension? Can I just go ahead and show this particular, you know, chart or this particular test? So based on that, you can decide. And it's always good to test binocularly first, because if you try for a monocular, one monocular is perfect, we all know that. But in an attempt to try for monocular, for all you know, you may not end up having anything in place. If the child is, like, you know, really off, then you may not get any acuity or any contrast sensitivity or any visual function to work with. So always get binocular first. And once you have that, it's easier to go ahead with the monocular. The child cooperates. Very good. And the second is the playway. Third is the playway method works the best. Sometimes in children, you know, you cannot be so strict and, you know, stand and, you know, literally tell them do this, do that. And, you know, you can't just be in a controlled environment. Yes, playway method works best. And you can see here, this child is being taught how to answer about the Lea symbols using this. So we are showing her the 3D Lea puzzle here and trying to get her acquainted. You may ask me that, you know, this child looks pretty old for her, if you know, to do this, but why is the child doing it? The child did have a traumatic brain injury, and post that had forgotten all the letters and was really finding it difficult to give verbal response for any of those. So we tried doing with this, and we were successful. So these are simple tips to assess visual functions in children. So factors, as we've just discussed, the various factors that affect the choice of tests of visual functions include the age, and as I mentioned, it's the developmental age, the chronological age, it's the familiarity. For all you know, we may show some fancy pictures, like, you know, on the on visual acuity chart, but the child may not be familiar with it, right? So try to find out how much the child is familiar. And another thing here is, the child may be familiar. For example, in the Lea symbols, the child may call the circle as ball, or may call something else, like, you know, in the regional language. It's okay. You don't have to teach the child what it is. If the child is consistently telling it, please encourage the child to do so. The third is obviously attention. it's well known that children do have less attention. So try to get your visual function assessment as quick as possible. Okay, sometimes, in fact, it may have to be even before history taking in certain cases. So it goes on individual to individual basis. So you can take the call on that. The last one is obviously comprehension. So moving on to the visual acuity charts, we see that, you know, all these are, I'm sure you all know very well about these charts here. So the one to the extreme left is the Logmar letter chart. So if the child is able to respond to this, nothing like it, just go ahead. You can ask the child, do a monocular assessment as well. But many a times in children, this seems to be a little difficult. Especially in those who are just starting to go to school or who do not have formal education skill. So they may actually have difficulty in this. So then we all obviously have other alternatives. But for example, let me take this case. If a child is having difficulty in calling this as P, instead of calling this as P, let's say child is calling this as R or N as H, which very commonly happens, right? So in these cases, what I usually do is I don't jump to the other chart. What I usually do is I give a pen and a paper and ask the child to write what he or she is seeing there. Now, the reason behind that, if you just look at the chart to the, you know, which is to the right side of it, that is the HOTV or Sheridan Gardner, what we call, there are only four optotypes. Now, from here, if you jump there or to the Lea symbols otherwise, what happens is there are only four optotypes that you have. So there is 25% chance of the child anyway being correct. So would you like that to happen? Like, you know, you will go ahead and ask him, like, you know, what is this? What is this? What is this? And anyway, it's going to be correct because there's 25% chance of the child anyway being correct. So wherein here, herein, there is lot of, the letters are not very commonly used. Okay. So in that case, the randomness is less, right? So that is important. So I would just give a pen and paper and ask them to write down what they're seeing. If the child is able to write the stroke of the letter, that's enough. That's more than enough for us. Based on that, we can assess the visual acuity. Now, moving on to the HOTV chart. Again, it doesn't need much of introduction. We've already mentioned whatever we've spoken there also applies here, except that as we know that there are four optotypes only. So the 25% chance of it anyway being correct always exists. And herein we have this matching cards. So what you can do is first ask the child what it is. If the child is not able to respond, then just ask them to match. So matching acuity can be done. The other option is the K pictures. Now looking at Lea symbols, a bit of important tips here, I should say, is, as I mentioned earlier, don't teach the child what it is. Okay, the child may want to call it apple or anything as such, just leave it to the child. As long as he or she is consistently calling it across the chart, okay? And I also don't give the matching card right away. The reason is children often actually get confused when there is something up there and also something in the hand. They don't know which one to look at. And sometimes the responses go variable. So that's the reason. First, if you're teaching the child, remove the distance chart, just take the matching card, teach them what it is if they need. If they don't, then straight away put that up and you can take from there. And also the matching card can be the last resort that you can follow. In children who are not able to, you know, who are too playful or, you know, not having good attention to respond to this two-dimensional optotypes, then you can actually move on and ask them to play with this 3D puzzle for some time. It actually interests the kids a lot. So you can just, put the puzzle, we can ask them to put the puzzle together. First, we do it usually in the color mode, and then, you know, you flip it over and then there's this black and white mode. So after doing that, then you can encourage the child to, okay, so let's try this on this chart. So this playway method of testing works wonderful in children, and try to always do that as much as possible whenever needed, right? So this is a matching acuity card assessment in progress. So whatever we discussed until now has been about the recognition acuity. Now, if you think about it, if you just think about, you know, the concept here, first of all, one needs to resolve between the black and white, right? Or everything is nothing but, you know, first resolution acuity is needed, right? Followed by one has to identify that, yes, this is a square or this is a TV, whatever you want to call it, right? So there are two things here. One is resolve it. And second is recognize what it is. So recognition obviously needs comprehension again, but in the cases where recognition acuity is not possible, if it is difficult, you don't want to just write as not cooperative. Move on to the resolution acuity. So there are kids who are even of 10 years age, 12 years age, even sometimes 16, 17 years age, we go ahead and do resolution equity if need be, if they are not responding to any of those charts. Okay, instead of just writing child is responding to, you know, bright colored objects or colorful objects, instead of that, have some quantifiable measures in place. Well, you can do that as well to get an idea, but having quantifiable measures is always good because it serves a good comparison, right? So here we see that these are resolution equity tools. So this one again doesn't need much of an introduction. This is nothing but Teller equity cards. So herein you see there's a grating either on the right or to the left. It follows two alternate forced choice preferential looking paradigms. So this is the tag stage. So this is just to avoid the distraction. You can do it with that. And in fact, if at all you find it difficult because of, you know, the child's limited neck holding and all of that, you find it difficult, the child will not cooperate with the stage on there. So no problem. You can just make the child sit on the mother's lap also and do it close by, right? But ensure that the working distance is all measured. So this is about the grating equity, Teller equity cards. The next one is again also grating equity, and this is a Lea gratings paddle. So the one disadvantage of this is there is no specific stage to ensure that the distraction is limited. Here the child can get distracted because, you know, just behind the card is the examiner's face. So that kind of a thing, try as much as possible so that the examiner's face is covered. So again, it's a two alternate forced choice paradigm. But the biggest advantage of Lea gratings is it's much more portable. You can take it for screening also, and, you know, it's easier to practice in the clinic. Now, looking at the Cardiff equity cards, it's on the principle of vanishing equity optotypes. So the optotypes are either on the top or the bottom. If the child is able to tell what it is, like able to say, yeah, this is fish, this is house, very good. If the child is not able to see, just ask them to point out whether it's up or down. Or in fact, even if they don't give a verbal response, at least a non-verbal response also will do, even if they are just looking. So you have to, in the grating equity, the most important thing that the examiner needs to do is assess the eye movements. So judge the eye movements, not assess, judge the eye movements, whether the child is looking to the right, to the left, up, down, is the child able to follow exactly, okay? And many a times, examiner can get confused here because it did happen with me as well. Many a times we can be confused, oh yes, the grating was towards the right, so yes, the child is looking towards the right. As much as possible, try not to be biased. If possible, you know, you don't look at the grating, location of the grating before you present to the child. Once you do that, then look and see, yes, the grating is towards, I saw the child's movements towards this side, and yes, the grating is also towards that side. So that allows you to be unbiased, okay? So try to practice that, and obviously, you know, keep all these things, what I told you in mind, yeah. So moving on, there are, you know, in this grating equity, we see that there's been some improvement in terms of, you know, advancement in terms of these tests being available as apps. So I'll just play this video for you all here. Okay. Very good. Very good. You should wait now. Okay. Okay, so you've seen, right? So this is called as the Peekaboo Vision app. It's available on the iOS platform. So just to explain if things were not clear there, there are two circles, you know, on the entire screen. And on one circle, there is grating, and the other circle is of homogeneous gray background. If the child presses on the correct side of the grating, where the grating is present, there is this video interactive feedback that pops up, and, you know, that yippee sound with the green cartoon that pops up. And actually, that is for encouraging the child to continue with the test. Okay, so that is about the Peekaboo Vision app. And we'll also look at another app, which is right now in the development phase. It's called Oko Health. I'll just play this video for you. So the task here is for the child to actually pop those circles of different spatial frequency that came up, like, you know, you've seen the stimuli size is different. So the task is to pop those circles. So it is an eye-hand coordination task. So this does demand a good eye-hand coordination. And even peekaboo vision that way demands eye-hand coordination. But since there are only two, it's a two alternate force choice, it's much more easier to understand. Even if the child is not giving an eye-hand coordination, but simply looking towards it, still, and the examiner can, you know, understand where is the child looking and go ahead and click it for the child. So, okay. So these are the apps for visual or grading acuity.
Okay.
Now moving on, as I just mentioned, even having this functional vision measures also in place is important. So if in case none of these things, whatever we discussed until now, these charts, tests are not working, working in the sense the child is not able to respond either verbally or non-verbally or not getting any meaningful information to work with, then still you can try to go ahead and do the functional vision assessment. Now herein, we know different patterns and different lights are shown to the child, and actually the response towards that is assessed. So in fact, all the visual functions can be assessed in a functional way, that is in a little playway method with these simple tools. Okay, so this also can be done. And in fact, using the app also, one can just try to understand whether the child is able to follow the circles, at what speed, what is the size. So these cannot be interpreted as your CPD or Snellen fraction definitely, but it will give you an understanding of the visual ability of the child. And thereby you can plan the rehabilitative management. So that is about the visual acuity assessment. There are some do's and don'ts that I would like to mention here. Always use the top-down approach. What I mean by top-down approach is, now for example, if a four-year-old comes in, you cannot assume that the child may not be familiar with letters. Nowadays, kids are very fast. For all you know, they may be very good with the letters. So if you start off showing from the grating acuity, just because it's a four-year-old, or, you know, just start off with a Lea symbol, then you have to go one chart up high. So it's easier to come, you know, in the top-down approach. And at times, as I mentioned earlier, visual acuity assessment or visual function assessment can even be before the history taking. If the child is having limited attention span and you see the child is really active when he or she came into the room, then why not take good advantage of that and get your visual functions quantified. And yes, playway method as and when needed. Appreciate as how much ever is needed, not probably after every response a child gives, but yes, appreciation does work in children. And as I mentioned, do binocular first. There are three don'ts that I would like to mention, especially when, you know, when we are handling difficult cases in the clinic. It's obvious, you know, sometimes that many people clutter in the room. Many people, like many examiners, want to see how exactly is the clinician dealing. So one thing you need to understand is the child may not, give a good response if there are too many examiners in the room, and also if it's a cluttered room. So having too many things in the examination room, you have seen the pediatric, wards or pediatric rooms being painted in the brightest of colors and having so many toys. Sometimes, you know, this can actually be a distraction, because why would the child actually want to look at your black and white grating and your black and white autotypes when there are much more attractive things in the room? Right. So at least when you're examining within your visual examination space, that particular space, at least keep it decluttered as much as possible. I know usually in kids, for kids' interests, we usually have some play areas and all of them in place. But yes, keep it a little away from the examination room. And negative comments. Even if the child goes wrong, please do not pass any negative comments. Always encourage the child to go ahead with the test. We'll move on to contrast sensitivity. I should say one of the most important visual functions and one of the most ignored as well. It is very, very ignored, not only for pediatric, but even in general also. But actually, this is very much important for our real world functioning as such. So we see that, again, this doesn't need much of an introduction. It's a Pelli-Robson chart. We all know, one of the gold standards for assessing contrast sensitivity. So if the child can do it, go ahead. The second is the Logmar low contrast acuity chart. So one thing here you can remember is, once you have the high contrast acuity in place, you have the low contrast acuity, any two or more lines difference between the high and low contrast gives you an idea about the child's contrast sensitivity. So you can say that yes, two or more lines difference exists. So then child is having impaired contrast sensitivity. So yes, you can do your low contrast assessment using this chart. The other options for children is, you can even have the Lea symbols that's in the center, you can use this. Or else, you know, when kids are too small or not responsive to any of these optotypes, you can go for hiding AD cards, which has this face as the optotype. So again, it's a two alternate force choice preferential looking test. So here an equal movement of both the cards at a given time is very important, because if one card, you know, if only the card that has the face has movement always, then it will be easier for the child to judge at least based on the movement. Okay, so don't do that. Have equal movement of both the cards when you're presenting them to the child. Okay, and then we also have this new app called Oko Health. I'll just play this video for you all here. So yeah, as you've seen, it is about popping those circles of different contrast levels. So at a time, four visual stimuli are presented and the task is for the child to pop them. So again, it does require good eye-hand coordination. So yeah, moving on to visual fields, you cannot ignore visual fields just because the kids cannot do Humphrey visual fields test, right? If the kid is able to do very well, go ahead. Let them do it based on the ocular condition. You can decide whether the child does need a visual field assessment for peripheral fields or not. That you can decide. However, if the child you're sure is not going to cooperate for the HVF, but still you want to get a field test done, I would suggest that do a confrontation. So a regular confrontation can also be done using this particular tool. This is called as Lea flickering wand. So it's fun way of doing actually. We ask the examiner or, you know, the other, if there are two examiners, one examiner can sit in front of the child with some toy. Again, the toy shouldn't be too attractive. Okay. It shouldn't be a bright color like yellow or red. It can be a little milder color, and then sit in front and show that particular toy. And then you can ask the child that, you know, as and when you see the light, you know, you can just grab it. Okay. So the second examiner can come from behind, like how you see here in this picture. So as in when the child responds, so this is not going to give you exact a visual field map. It cannot plot like HVF, but it can approximately tell, yes, child does have, you know, right field constriction or inferior field constriction. Okay. So that kind of important bits of information you can pick up from the Lea flickering wand. Now, the other one is the pediatric perimeter. This has been patented at our institute, and this has been developed by Dr. Premnandi Sadgunam working in our institute. She's a scientist. So we see that here it's a very interesting one actually. So the child is made to lie in the supine position and the lights are shown across these different meridians that you see. Even a quadrant, only quadrants also can be studied, only hemi also can be studied, and even the meridian wise. So the complete isopter as such can be plotted using the pediatric perimeter. So very soon it's going to be available clinically as well. And commercially, yeah. So that is about the pediatric perimeter. You can read more about this paper in TVST 2017. So looking at the color vision test, we all agree that this is also important for children. So if at all it's possible, you can do a Ishihara. If at all the child is not able to do so well, you can use some different nice patterns which the child will appreciate, like a star, a circle, a square, and ask them. If the child is not able to tell what it is, no problem, they can just trace it also. Fansur D16 may be a little bit of challenge for these kids, but as and when needed, if the children cooperate, you can go ahead with that. Looking at the other tests of visual function, we all agree that refraction is very important. Now, when we say refraction, yes, as I told you, retinoscopy values have to be more, like even if it takes a minute or two, spend more time, get your retinoscopy values correct. And another simple way is if the child is not able to look so far at the optotype that you present, even if the distance is there, but the optotype is a little boring for the child, you can have a video running. So at least, you know, to some extent, you can take care of the accommodation effect. And obviously, we all have to, as in how the case demands, we all go ahead with the cycloplegic refraction. So keep that at the back of your mind. And also the point that I mentioned here is about using estimation methods. So we all know that in children, they don't allow us to put too many trial lenses, you know, even putting the trial frame may be difficult in them, and then putting too many trial lenses, like you, if you go in 0.5 diopter step and keep checking, the child will get very irritated about it. So ensure that you take little larger steps, get it done there. And then if the child is cooperative, just try to refine your steps. So use estimation methods as and when needed, like, you know, the enhancement technique as and when needed for uncorrected hyperopias and for myopic estimation technique, just changing the distance. So all these estimation techniques can be used. And yes, if the child is able to give a subjective response and subjective refraction, perfect, go ahead with that. And otherwise also, you can more or less rely on your retinoscopy values and prescribe the glasses. Binocular vision tests, again, are very important because most of these kids can have issues in the stereopsis or depth perception and accommodation and vergence. So you can use simple tools like the Randolph stereo test, or even a very fun way of testing is the stereo smile test called PASS. So again, it's a two alternate forced choice preferential looking. Again, it's a blank card there. There's a smiley face there. Ask the child, where is the smiley face? It's a very gross way of testing the contrast. You cannot come as, fine as 40 seconds of arc, but yes, you can get some understanding about their stereopsis. And accommodation and vergence also need to be tested in these children. So I have few case examples here, and you can probably answer them also if you are interested, and probably you can post it in the chat box for me, Solu. So these are just for your understanding. So whatever we've learned till now, we'll try to see how we can actually use that bit of information. And also, these case examples are mostly focused for helping you understand about the assistive devices. Okay, because bringing up this topic of assistive devices, showing the complete range of devices, will be very difficult in this limited time that we have. So I thought it's good to discuss that as part of the case examples. So here we have a kid. The case one is about a child who is a 10-year-old girl who is studying in grade 5. So this bit of information should help you all understand that yes, the child is age appropriate. A 10-year-old usually is in grade 5. So cause of low vision in this case is pathological myopia in both eyes. So her best corrected visual acuity. Now notice I have not mentioned the presenting visual acuity. I'm directly going to the best corrected visual acuity, that is 20/50. So we see that the refraction with a refraction value of -8 diopters, the child is reading up to 20/50, both in the right eye and in the left eye. And the best corrected visual acuity for near is N6 at 10 centimeters with Bailey-Lowy bird reading chart and a room illumination. Now, while I'm discussing these cases, I want you all to also pay attention to the bits of information that I've mentioned here. It's very important that you write down the working distance at which you're assessing for the near. It's very important because a child reading, not only a child, any patient reading N6 at 10 centimeters versus someone reading N6 at 40 centimeters, there's a huge difference. There's a huge difference. So it's very important that you write down at what distance, working distance or the reading distance, the child is presenting to you there in the clinic. And the other thing is you also have to write with which chart the child is able to read this. Now, for example, in the follow-up visit, if someone tries to show some other chart, then it's not of comparison. We all know that no two tests agree so well with each other. So it's good to always mention which reading, which near vision chart you're using. And even for distance, in fact, you can write as to whether it is using the Logmar letters or whether you use Lea symbols. Now, the reason behind this is there are several papers out there which actually suggest that no two tests, especially in the pediatric group, can actually be compared. So it's good to always mention so that it can serve as a comparison later on in the follow-up. And also the other bit of information was room illumination. So this is again very important, whether you're giving extra illumination to the child or the child is just able to do it in the room illumination. So all these bits of information are important for the near acuity. Now moving on, the actual activity limitation of this child is unable to read books for longer time due to neck pain. So the child is able to read N6. No issues with that, absolutely. But the child is having difficulty to read due to neck pain. So at 10 centimeters, if the child is maintaining continuously for reading his or her books, obviously the child is going to end up having neck pain. So in these cases, how would you go ahead and manage? What would you do? Because you already given the refractive correction here. You already addressed that bit. But the child is having difficulty in reading books for longer time due to neck pain. So yeah, that's something that you can think about. Okay, so we've just gone ahead and given her this reading stand that you can see here. A very useful assistive device, I should say. It's a non-optical device. So just keeping that reading material in a slanting position with the help of reading stand can help her a lot for not having the neck issues. So her posture-related comfort is going to improve now. Okay, so she can read even for a longer period of time. Since she's a grade 5 student, for all you know, she may have much of reading work. So it's good to have a reading stand. The second thing is, if you notice, the child is reading N6 at 10 centimeters. This is optional again. We've demonstrated a low power, like a 2x dome magnifier. It can also be a stand magnifier that you can demonstrate. So we've seen that the child is really responding very well to that. Now the reason is the child is reading N6, and if the font is just at N8 or N6 at the threshold level, the child will have struggle in reading it for longer time. So it's an optional thing. If the child is reading bigger font, like, you know, N10, N12, then no need to go for the magnifier. But herein, when we've given her, demonstrated it to her, the child was really appreciating using the device. So this is a simple way of how to go ahead with the low vision management. Now let's look at the second case, an interesting case, I should say. A 4-year-old girl again, not joined school yet. The cause of low vision is rod monochromatism. I'm sure you would see these cases back there also. So the best corrected visual acuity for distance is 20/253 with LIA symbols. The child had not joined school yet, so we had to go with the LIA symbol assessment. The child was following the matching acuity, right? So herein, when we recorded the best rated near visual acuity for near, we see that it was N12 at 15 centimeters with LIA symbols chart under room illumination. Sorry, that got a miss there. So we see here that the child is having N12 near acuity. Now, however, the chief concern of the parents is totally different, right? They are asking, you are sitting there, the clinician is sitting there, and they are straight away asking you, can I join my child in school? 4-year-old obviously should be going to school. Now the question is, can I join my child in the school in the upcoming academic year? Now, what would you recommend? Now, based on your suggestion, they are going to actually decide whether to go ahead with the school or not, right? So what would you advise? The second concern is unable to open eyes completely in the sunlight. Now, this is more straightforward. We all know that in rod monochromatism, glare is very obviously seen. Like in other cases, like albinism, aniridia, cone dystrophy, even in rod monochromatism, this is seen. In fact, for all you know, in rod monochromatism, the children can have even problem even in the room light also. The room illumination, which seems to be ambient or pleasant for us, may cause glare for them. So in this case, we went ahead and gave this filter to the child, and we can see the smile on her face. So all that she needed was a filter. Now, if the child is having a significant refractive correction, you can go ahead and give a prescription tinted glasses. Okay, so it can have the prescription in place and also the tint. Whereas if the child is only having problem in the sunlight, not in the room light, then you can go ahead with the photochromatic correction. So based on the refractive correction, you can decide that, right? So those are the important bits of information. Just a filter can make the difference. Now about the first question, can I join my child in school? Obviously, yes, there is no reason why this child cannot be joined in school. Now the second question the parents ask, should I join my child in that, special school where they teach Braille, or can my child study in regular school? The child definitely doesn't need to go to special school for the blind. In fact, all children can study in mainstream schools. Okay, with the support of the teachers, with the support of the school management, all children do have the right to study in the mainstream school. So that has to be encouraged. And you can definitely tell them, yes, your child can join in school right away whenever, it's possible immediately. And the second thing, what I would do extra for this child, even though the child is not still familiar with letters, is I would still go ahead and demonstrate a device for distance, a device for near to the parents and also to the child. Now, the reason why I would do this, is because I want them to have an understanding as to when the child starts learning letters and has challenges in the school, how will she manage them? Right? If the parents say, yes, madam, we followed your advice, we put her in the school, but my child is not able to read the letters in the book. Now, what do I do? So in order for them to get prepared with what the child is going to face, now rod monochromatism, we all know it's an irreversible condition, right? So in that case, you can show a low powered magnifier just for, a demo purpose. Show a dome magnifier or show a simple stand magnifier and see how is the child reading with that, right? And also, the other thing is for distance, you can go ahead and show a telescope, right? Even at times when it is very difficult with the monocular, you can explain them that, this requires training. Many a times parents question this. Oh, chashma hi nahi pehnti hai madam, glasses itself is difficult. How will my child use a telescope? That's a very valid question, which any parent would ask. So then you need to tell them that, yes, we are going to train the child. And after the child is very clear with the training session, you know, how to hold it, how to fix it, follow all the visual skills involved in the telescope, using the telescope, and then writing, how will she write with it, how will she read with it. You are going to do the word per minute count also. And then only the parents will have an idea. Then the parents can confidently join the child in school. Now, one other area that we actually address in our institute is if there are schools that deny admission for these children, we even have advocacy in place. That is also one of our very important component. So what we do is we write recommendation letter and, you know, back it up and give it to the parents for their use, so that this child can actually be allowed to study in the regular school. Even if that is not possible, even then, if he or she is denied, then we actually approach the school authorities from our institute. So these are the things that we can actually plan for the betterment of the child. Now that is about the case two. Moving on, let's discuss about case three. Now this is more into the optical devices. So this is a 16-year-old boy who is in grade 11, again age appropriate. Cause of low vision is macular dystrophy in both eyes, so a central field loss. Best corrected visual acuity for distance is 20 by 160 and for the near acuity is N16 at 15 centimeters. Okay, so I'm straight away mentioning best corrected visual acuity here, given the time constraints, but yes, you have to obviously look at what is the presenting visual acuity, do a refraction, do an objective and subjective refraction, and then only you will be getting this best corrected visual acuity for both distance and near. And then looking at activity limitations. Now this grade 11 boy is complaining that he has difficulty in copying from the board in the classroom, which is very obvious. Having a 20 by 160 acuity, obviously he is going to face it. And also unable to read fine prints in the books, again, which is obvious because he's having only N16. And for all you know, because he's in grade 11, he may have a need to read even N8 print also. Because as small as in the newspaper, right? There could be a need. So unable to read fine print in books, he's well above the threshold level. I mean, he's reading well below the threshold level, okay? So keep all these things in mind, keep his activity limitations in mind as we discuss about the devices. So for this child, we went ahead and showed him a telescope. Now, how did we go about the telescope assessment? How did we go about selecting the telescope? So there's formula behind it, which I couldn't put it up here, but yes, you can use the ratio of the denominator of the best corrected visual acuity and divide it with the denominator of the target visual acuity. Now the way you're going to use this target visual acuity is if the child is able to say, now a 16-year-old boy obviously is expected to give you that response. So once you put the letters on the chart there, your comp log or whatever you're using, you can approximately ask, you know, what distance do you sit from the board? First question. Second is, what is the smallest size your lecturer writes on the board? So once the child points out approximately it is like 2050 or 2040, take that as a target. Because usually for distance, it is like a spot reading task. You're not going to read for very long continuously like for near. So you don't need any reserve maintenance and all that, which I'm going to talk in the next slide. So after getting that, you're just going to divide. Like example, let's take 20 by 160. So 160 divided by 40. So it gives 4x magnification. So with 4x telescope, we see the child is comfortably able to read what is on the board. Now, this particular picture that you see here is a training session in progress. So these devices, especially the telescope, cannot be prescribed off the counter. You cannot say, yeah, you can use a 4x telescope like glasses and just write and give it off. The child does need training. Okay, ensure that all the visual skills are intact, all are perfect, and you know, has a good word per minute, and only then go ahead and prescribe the telescope. So that is about the prescription of telescopes. How do you go about in selecting? And then we also have to address his near concern. He has N16 at 15 centimeters, right? So regarding that, when we look at it, approximately there is 6x magnification we get. Now this is dependent on the formula of EVP. EVP stands for equivalent viewing power, which is the best formula to calculate the magnification for near. The reason I said best is because it uses very important parameters. One is it uses the distance, the working distance at which the child is reading, which is very important, and also uses at what is the target acuity the child wants to achieve. For all you know, the child has N16, the child may just want to read N8, right? So if the child wants to read N8, then do you want to just give it at N8? Now, for example, let me ask you this question. I'm sure like, most of you may have like, you know, you all are younger, so you all may even read N2 also. You probably can read N2, N3 also, right? Now, if I print a 500 pages book and give you all lecture notes of N3 size and ask you all to read continuously for 1 hour. Will you feel comfortable? You all will feel very uncomfortable. Not that you can't read it. You can read it, but you are reading at your threshold level. Okay, so you don't want to read anything at your threshold level because you will feel strained. If it's for spot reading, it's fine. If it's like just seeing MRP or just trying to find out what is the expiry date on the medicine that you're seeing, it's fine. But if you have to read continuously, make notes out of it, study for your exam, you're going to find it very difficult. So that is the reason we always take things in reserve. So from threshold, like example, if child has to read N8, I'm going to take my target as 3 lines in reserve. So from N8, it moves to N6, N5, N4. So I'm going to aim at N4 so that he reads N8 correctly, much more easily, fluently, right? So that is how we plan. So again, the concept of critical print size comes here into picture, how fluently the smallest size a patient can read fluently without much errors. So you take usually 3 lines in reserve whenever you're dealing for near acuity for prolonged reading tasks. Okay, for spot reading tasks, you can just keep even 1 line reserve, or without that also still it may work, right? So this particular child, we had given trial of both non-illuminated. The one that you see here is non-illuminated to the left. The one that you see here to the right is the illuminated stand magnifier. And we have not given a trial of handheld magnifier because we want this child to read comfortably for longer time. Now, handheld magnifier, there is no pre-focused distance, right? So then one has to continuously keep focusing it. That is going to become very difficult for the child. So we straight away went to the stand magnifier. But this child, however, told us that using an iPad, he was comfortably able to read the print, like, you know, just by zooming it. Okay, so even iPad, tablet, any of it works. So if the child is able to manage that way, no problem. You don't have to force a child to use a particular optical device as such. If the child is comfortably managing, nothing like it. So moving on to case number 5. So this is going to be our last case when we are talking about the low vision. Then when we move to children with special needs, I have another case to discuss. So I hope these cases are helping. I hope you're getting things in perspective, you know, while we discuss about this. So again, this is about a grade 11 boy, a 16-year-old male. And if you've observed across all the 5 cases, most of them are age appropriate, but this is not the case. Usually in the clinics, sometimes we see 16-year-olds studying in still grade 7 and mostly attributed to visual reasons. So you need to keep all that also at the back of your mind while we are discussing these cases. The cause of low vision here is Leber's congenital amaurosis, and the best corrected visual acuity for distance is 20 by 1200. So you've seen that is a best corrected, not presenting. So it's a severe visual impairment case that you're dealing here with. And best corrected visual acuity for near is N63 at 20 centimeters with very low word reading chart under room illumination. Now the child obviously is going to have more activity limitations than what I listed here. For all you know, the child may have even problem in walking without bumping into objects and various other difficulties. But the primary ones for our discussion are unable to copy from the board in the classroom, unable to read fine prints in the books. Okay, so these are his concerns. So how did we go ahead and deal with this? So just to help you all understand, first let's talk about his reading activity, reading from the books. So we went ahead and demonstrated this TV electronic magnifier or CCTV mouse that we call. I'm sorry if this is not very clear, but this is a mouse here which works on the principle of projection magnification. So whatever reading material, okay, is underneath this particular mouse, which has a camera here, gets projected onto the screen that you're focusing. Like herein, it's a TV screen. So the child can comfortably read whatever is in the newspaper. So this particular one ranges, it goes even up to 70 to 100 times also of magnification. It has such high magnification. So even children who have severe visual impairment can also comfortably manage using these devices. So there's another option of reverse polarity for especially those who have glare concerns with this white background shining too much into the eyes or glary. So then they can go with the reverse polarity, that is black screen with white letters, that is of much more comfort. It's not given here in the picture. Yeah, it's given here in this portable video magnifier picture. So these are an option. This is an option. And the second option is We can also show a portable video magnifier, given that this child would want to carry it back to the college, come back. So in those cases, you can go ahead and show this kind of a portable video magnifier. Now, these are just prototypes that I'm showing. Obviously, there are, we have different models. You have a little bigger size also. We have even a 7-inch screen. So you can show as per the need. And obviously, the other different concerns also would come into picture. What is the cost of the device? What's the affordability? What is the range of availability that you have in your stock? So several other factors also come into picture. So in this case, for the child to copy from the board, there are, in fact, the one such device, this is not exactly the one, but one such device which can be used for near is of multitasking. It's a multitasking video magnifier that can also be focused on to distance. So that can pick up what the lecturer or the teacher is writing on the board as well. So these kind of devices can be used, or else if the child just wants to use his auditory cues to function in the class, whatever the lecturer is dictating, he or she wants to just write down the notes, that also, these are simple solutions but useful, right? So all of these things you need to think about. So we move on to video magnifiers or electronic devices, not only in cases of severe visual impairment. You can even demonstrate even in the moderate visual impairment group also, because it allows good binocularity. It is, it doesn't allow, it doesn't give that restricted working distance of, maintaining it too close. You can maintain a longer working distance, good contrast to work with. So these are the various reasons why electronic devices can be prescribed even for the moderate visual impairment. Now we'll kind of slightly shift gears and talk about children with special needs. Okay, so herein, first of all, when we say special needs, why are we discussing about them, first of all, in this pediatric low vision? Because I feel the topic of pediatric low vision will be incomplete if we do not discuss about these children, because these children also have visual impairment plus other areas of concerns. Okay, so special needs essentially is an umbrella term that refers to an array of diagnoses that includes delays and disabilities. It is used to identify mental, physical, or psychological disabilities that affect a person's function and behavior. Now, that is a definition for you. Let me just break it down for your ease of understanding. So essentially, we all understand that the child's overall development is the ultimate goal for which we all want to work at, right? Overall development is very important. It's not just, okay, achieving visual acuity of 20/20. That's not the only goal. The overall development is what we are trying to see. So in this aspect, there are several various sensory areas that contribute towards this overall development. Vision, obviously, is one such. Motor, speech, auditory, and cognition. All of these sensory areas contribute towards this very important component of overall development. Okay, so why are the needs of these children special? Why are these children actually labeled as having special needs? If you think about it, one thing to understand is because of these areas, what we just discussed, these sensory areas having delays or disabilities, okay, there are needs that are specifically difficult for the child to do on his or her regular day-to-day lives, in their day-to-day lives. So that is the reason these needs are termed as special. And that is how this whole term of children with special needs comes about. So let me just ask you this question. Have you ever thought about it? Is seeing equivalent to vision? Is seeing equivalent to vision? So let me, just ask you all to have a look at the picture here that is seen. Can you help me understand as to what is the meaningful information that you can gather from this picture? What do you see in this picture? For all you know, you may come up and tell me, yeah, I see a white background with black patches distributed everywhere, black dots everywhere. What is the important or meaningful information that you can get? But if I'm going to show you the picture that is there on the right, okay, bringing these dots that are there, okay, bringing these black patches to a visual closure by giving this an outline, you're going to tell me, yes, I see a dog kind of an animal, okay, there, right there, trying to eat something or just putting its head down, right? So this is kind of the meaningful information that you give me. So the picture that you just saw to your left was actually seen. You just saw it, but you couldn't interpret as to what it is about, right? So what you see will get interpreted only when you have this visual perceptual skills. So seeing is definitely not directly equal to vision. Visual perceptual skills involve the ability to organize and interpret the information that is seen and give it meaning. So without giving it meaning, this would have been a meaningless information. Just seeing that, you know, there are various objects in the room and not trying to understand that, yes, this specific object is a TV or this specific object is a bottle. Only then you're going to give some meaningful information out of it, right? So seeing directly is not vision. Okay, the reason I'm shifting towards this is we have spoken about ocular visual impairment. Now we are going to spend few minutes talk about neurological visual impairment, because these children have visual impairment, but because of neurological causes, right? So talking about them, there are various delays, disabilities that these children have, which I just pointed out, right? The vision, motor, speech, so and so. But other than that, these children have problems, especially in their vision. If we talk, they have difficulties in their higher order visual processing functions. You may ask me, what is this difficult term that you're talking about, right? Let us talk about these two popular visual streams, okay? So from the occipital lobe, we all know where is the visual cortex located. That's in the occipital lobe. So from the occipital lobe, traveling towards the parietal lobe, right? From the occipital, traveling towards the parietal is the dorsal visual stream, which is also called as the where or the how pathway. Okay? It's also called as the where or the how pathway. Now, traveling from the occipital lobe towards our temporal lobes is the ventral stream, also called as the what pathway. Right? There are very important visual perceptual skills that these two particular pathways do. Right, have. So one other important thing I would like to mention here is recent theories have been that there are several functions which both of them do in integration with each other. So it's really very difficult to tease out saying that, yes, this particular function is only of dorsal visual stream. Yes, but predominantly it belongs to that particular visual stream is what we can infer. So we see that the first one is visual spatial awareness. So we see this child is having the food from the tiffin. His lid is somewhere, the yellow color lid, and you know, there's a small blue color tiffin box also here. So, just plug this in. Sorry, give me a minute. Thank you. So, we see that if the child is actually missing out where specifically he kept his lid, okay, that could be because of his poor visual spatial awareness. Now, not being aware of where exactly is the particular object in your visual space can be related to poor visual spatial awareness. Now, this function is predominantly that of the dorsal visual stream. The second is visual motor integration. Now, this child is playing with some puzzles there, right? So, or else it could be a simple eye-hand coordination task also. Trying to put something over the other, the building blocks and all of that. All of these need good eye-hand coordination tasks. So it could be difficulty in the visual motor integration. Motion perception, we all understand, having difficulty in perceiving the motion. Recognition of faces, like now whatever we spoke about, the first three are related more to predominantly the functions of dorsal visual stream. Now let's move on to the others. That is recognition of faces. So recognition of faces, now this famous personality whom we can actually recognize without seeing, you know, the complete face also appears like this as a split, you know, in different split images to a child who has ventral stream dysfunction. So recognition of faces becomes very challenging for these children. Now the other one is recognition of shapes or sizes. So as I told you, ventral is about what? So it's more into what of things, right? And also children having problem with dorsal and ventral stream have difficulty in perceiving two or more visual stimuli at a given time. So essentially what we call as simultagmosia. Okay, so these are the higher order visual functions, visual processing functions which children with neurological visual impairment can have. So what are the conditions? Okay, so in the clinic, you need to relate, right? So, okay, this condition comes in, then I understand that these children can have these difficulties. Now, let me tell you that all these visual processing functions, they have difficulties in addition to their reduced visual functions. So we spoke about acuity, contrast, visual fields, depth perception, color vision, all of them to a certain extent. Now, it varies condition to condition, child to child. All of them are affected. In addition to that, even these visual processing functions are affected. So moving on to the common conditions for your understanding, you know, these children can have cortical or cerebral visual impairment, cerebral palsies, Down syndrome. You would have come across this attention deficit hyperactive disorder, which we very popularly call as ADHD, autism spectrum disorder or ASD, developmental delay. Sometimes children are just labeled as having global developmental delay without any specific diagnosis, even learning disabilities, okay? So all these children come under this category of children with special needs. So in order to cater to their visual needs, we have commenced a special needs vision clinic at LV Prasad Eye Institute as part of the Institute for Vision Rehabilitation. So this is meant for both children and adults with special needs. So herein we use these conventional tools and even newer tools for assessing their visual functions as the need be. And also we have, this both therapeutic and diagnostic equipment in place using which we can provide therapies to these children. So this is one recent addition to our Institute for Vision Rehabilitation. So moving on to case six, the last case for today is of a 10-year-old girl. Informant are parents. Her developmental delays are in all the three areas, motor, speech, cognition. So essentially she has a global developmental delay and she's already been diagnosed to have cerebral visual impairment. The child, the parents did give us all this information. However, they mentioned also that the child has not undergone any rehabilitative therapies until now. So the chief complaints as mentioned by parents were the child doesn't make eye contact, does not fixate at light, but can follow the light inconsistently, not continuously, right? Not consistently. So these observations, what, this complaints that the parents actually told us, we also observed in the child. We've observed that, yes, this child does not make eye contact. When we are calling out her name, the child definitely was totally in a chin down position and did not want to respond. And nor was she actually fixating at light, right? So these were the observations we made too. So actually, let me, even before I tell you what was the acuity like, the child's referral, on the referral sheet, when we've seen her acuity was just dazzle reflex. A 10-year-old child having just dazzle reflex. So we were like, okay, let us try to see if we can assess her visual functions, in a much more better way, trying to get some quantifiable measures. So I use this Peekaboo Vision app that you see here. And that I just demonstrated the video about. I'm not going to do it here again. So here we've seen the child was responding close to 3 CPD, right? The child was responding close to 3 CPD, which was very good. Okay, some quantifiable measure. It didn't happen in the first, at least not in the first half an hour. We had to spend time with the child, try to make her talk something, try to get used to the new environment. So these are again important steps as part of the pediatric care, right? After that, the child could actually respond well. She did have poor eye-hand coordination, but she did make an attempt to touch it. And the second, just to confirm our findings, because we were actually amazed looking at her, moving from dazzle reflex to, 3 CPD, we tried to confirm this with the Cardiff Acuity cards that you see. So the child was not telling us to what this particular optotypes are, but she was pointing out towards it. And we recorded up to 20 by 160 in this kid. So that was really good. It was really encouraging for us as well. And then moving on, we see that once we've refracted her objective retinoscopy, we see that the child had minus one with minus one at 180. The kid did not go ahead with any subjective response. So one other important thing, now this didn't happen in the first visit as such, because we had to, the child was coming regularly for therapies after the first visit. So we went ahead with the yoke prism trial in the later on visit. So as I mentioned, the child had a chin down position. Now the reason why this child has a chin down position could be because of various reasons. Like for example, the child may have, inferior field loss, because of which it's a compensatory, chin down position that the child is having so that she doesn't bump into things. So in order, because if I'm going to give a yoke prism, okay, so we are essentially moving the entire visual space up, right? So in that case, if it is a compensatory chin down position, the child is definitely not going to be better with a yoke prism. She may have difficulty further, right? So that is the reason we've checked her visual fields first. Sorry for that. So that is the reason we've checked her visual fields first and then went ahead with the yoke prism trial. Then looking at her clinical examination with the SANET Vision Integrator that you see here. Just give me a minute. Thank you for patiently bearing with me. So with the SANET Vision Integrator, we see this is the SANET Vision Integrator, very similar to your vision therapy system, VTS. So there are different modules on this. So herein we use the proactive module to assess the eye-hand coordination. And we see that the child did have poor eye-hand coordination. It's actually not this child here. This is a child to whom about whom I'm referring to. I'll just play the video for you so that you understand this better, how the child is doing. Now, this is after 10 months of rehabilitative care.
Next karna kaha hai ping pong next left hand se karna.
So this is how the child was able to do after 10 months of complete care. I should say complete rehabilitative care, because we went ahead with the physiotherapy that was needed, with the speech therapy, with the special education, and obviously the vision therapy in the special needs vision care. So yeah, these were the different early intervention therapies that we have in place in the Institute for Vision Rehabilitation. This is the vision stimulation therapy in progress. This is the special education therapy. This is the speech therapy, and this is a physiotherapy. So again, going back to the overall development of the child is very important. And that's the reason we have everything under one umbrella, under the name of early intervention. So the clinical pearls that I would like to give out here, you know, after discussing all of these important aspects related to the pediatric care, is first is understand the functional limitations of the child. It's very important, because if you just try to just go only with the diagnosis and not try to understand what exactly are the concerns that the parents or caregivers are giving to you, or that you understand about the child, it's very difficult to go ahead with the assessment and the management. Again, going back to the with the same thing with which we started, what we mentioned as not cooperative, deferred, think twice before you write that. Think twice. Probably you may not have the skill set to assess this child. Introspect yourself, try to give it another shot. Probably you can be better this time. Concentrate on the child's residual vision. Okay, agreed that the child has visual impairment, agreed that this is irreversible vision loss, but concentrate on what the child still has. The residual vision may be 10%, 100%, 50%, 60%, whatever it is. But still, child has some residual vision which you can work around with. If the child is bilaterally no perception of light, then obviously we get more into, you know, the other sensory areas come into picture. Like, you know, you would want to concentrate more on the auditory skills and tactile cues and so on. Moving on, tailor make your clinical approach based on the child's developmental age and familiarity. So this is again very important, because just going as per the textbook definition of age appropriate tests may not work at times, especially in children with neurological visual impairment. So kindly consider that and tailor make your clinical approach accordingly. Another very important pearl is your advice should translate into doable things on a regular basis. Okay, so you have to, based on the family support the child has, okay, based on the motivation that you see from the, you know, the parents' motivation and so on, so many things that you need to consider to ensure that this translate into doable things on a regular basis. And the last one is make appropriate referral to co-manage your patients, because these children definitely may not just require the low vision services alone. They may need rehabilitative care. They may need other specialty care. So kindly co-manage your patients as per the need. So there are some resources here that, I usually read upon for gathering more information on these, on this field. So yeah, you can read these books. And also there are plenty of papers as well in this field that you can, search on PubMed and get. Thank you. So even before I, open it up for the question and answer session, I just wanted to end on this note that we do offer training programs at LVPI related to low vision rehabilitation, also for children with special needs. So yes, you can contact us on our helpline email ID or contact number. So that's up on the screen here. And to end with, I started with pediatric, but I'm ending with geriatric because we have an upcoming session on the 17th of September. It's free registration. It's called Elderly Eye Care Webinar Towards a Better Quality of Life. There are very well known speakers who are going to be there in this conference. So you all are free to register. So yeah, thank you. And yes, I'm ready to take questions or comments if any. Thank you.
So much, Ms. Ravika, for your wonderful session and mostly for your time. So as we have already run out of time, we will just be addressing one question for now, and the other question we will write to you on the mail. So that okay?
Yeah, okay. Go ahead, Soli.
So our first question goes from Mr. Azad. His question goes as, what about the prescribing of spectacle correction in child above 2 years of age with Duane's retraction syndrome associated with esotropia? You can also see the questions on the screen.
Yeah, you can just carry on, Ajaz. You can carry on with the prescription of the glasses just like how you would. And you would want to give a full correction also to the child based on the based on the diagnosis of esotropia. So yes, you can take a call based on the age appropriate management that you would do. Since a specific child doesn't have any specific cause of visual impairment as such, I don't think we would differ it in any different way for low vision assessment.
So I hope that answers the questions. So moving forward, so I guess we are not taking any questions as of now with the time limits. So we will be writing you all the questions on the mail and looking forward to your answers.
Sure, Solu, I'm sorry for overstepping in time, taking more time for the presentation. And you can definitely, write it in the email, and I would definitely love to answer the questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I hope that answers the questions of Mr. Azad, and other questions will be sending you very soon. And I hope this session benefited a lot of our audience. So, yeah. I would also like to inform you all that we are all set to publish our optometry magazine and journal of optometry. And if you want to participate through any means, you can write to us at mayuiofficial.com. So lately, I want to request Ms. Ravika to share her few words with Raffle. Over to you, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you, Solu, and especially thank you to Kapil for organizing this and for having me over. I also thoroughly enjoyed sharing this knowledge that I have on pediatric low vision with you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your time and for your wonderful insights. We would love to see you again in the future.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone, for tuning in. Hoping to see you all again further in the upcoming days.